In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. A warm welcome to all of you who have joined us this morning for this Eucharist. We are grateful for your presence with us, and are glad to be united with you in prayer. Together now, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honour of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance, we may also hold to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. A severe persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah to them. The crowd with one accord listened eagerly to what was said by Philip, hearing and seeing the signs that he did, for unclean spirits, crying with loud shrieks, came out of many who were possessed, and many others who were paralyzed or lame were cured. So there was great joy in that city. Now, when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. The two went down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet the Spirit had not come upon any of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from the first letter of Peter. In your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defence to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Jesus said to his disciples, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me, because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them.
The Gospel of the Lord.
The gospel we have just heard has Jesus preparing his disciples for the time when he would no longer be with them, at least not with them in the human sense, circumscribed by the laws of biology and physics. Because, of course, the whole point of what he is saying is that he would, in fact, continue to be with them, always. But it's more than a little confusing. We will soon celebrate the Lord's Ascension. But this morning's Gospel reading is taken from the words of the Lord Jesus to his disciples on the night before he died. Now, journalists or historians might be horrified at us taking what Jesus said before his crucifixion and applying it to the time after his resurrection. They could argue that we're taking the Lord's words out of context, or accuse us of putting our own spin on them. But the Gospels are not history books or news articles. They are the living word of God, and in a sense, we do put our own spin on them. We don't take them out of context. We put them in context. And that context is the resurrection. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus is the lens through which we see them. It is the amplifier through which we hear them. It is the reality through which we experience them. The resurrection makes the Lord's words in today's Gospel living words addressed not just to the disciples 2,000 years ago, but to each one of us listening today. And that is wonderful, consoling, and exciting. And of course, consolation is particularly welcome at a time when so many people are struggling, obliged to remain cocooned, living more solitary lives than they usually do, when so many people have no one to talk to today. In the words of the Gospel, Jesus is talking to all of us. As I say, wonderful, consoling, and exciting. But yes, it's a bit confusing. I was tempted to draw, or try at least, to draw a Venn diagram or a flowchart of the Lord's words in today's Gospel. Because there's lots of sort of cause and effect statements. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, I will ask my Father and he will send you another advocate. Because I live, you also will live. Those who love me will be loved by my Father. Those who love me, I will love them and reveal myself to them. A Venn diagram of all that would have lots of intersecting circles, and a flowchart would have arrows going all over the place. But that would be unnecessary. Jesus begins with, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments," and closes with, "They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me." So, in fact, we don't need fancy diagrams or charts. It's an infinite circle. To love Jesus is to keep his words and commandments, and to keep his words and commandments is to love him. The other thing he is telling us is that the presence of God abides, remains with, and dwells in his people always, beyond physical death and absence. Notice that Jesus promises that the Father will send another advocate, paraclete, another one. Because, of course, Jesus himself was the first one. The Spirit that is promised is the Spirit of truth. And we know that Jesus himself is the way, the truth, and the life. So it is his Spirit that the Father will send. He tells them that they will know the Spirit. They will because they know Jesus. And to know Jesus is to know the Father. Just as to know Jesus is to know the Father, you will know that I am in my Father, he says, and you in me, and I in you. The whole of salvation history is the story of God being with us. The great moments of divine disclosure, the creation, the incarnation, and Pentecost. When the Father's work is revealed, the Son's taking flesh is revealed, and the Spirit's descent is revealed, all reveal God pouring himself out and being present to the world. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit are one, and the great promise of today's Gospel is that not only does God not abandon his people or leave them orphans, he remains both powerfully and gently with us, dwelling in us, making us one with him, and drawing us into the unity of divine life. Good news for anxious times. St. Ephrem likens the Trinity to the Son, seeing the Father as fire, Jesus as light, and the Holy Spirit as heat. We know the Son is there, we can't touch or truly see the fire, but we can see the light and we can feel the heat. Different experiences, but one Son. The first, he says, the Father, is entirely self-contained. The next, Jesus, is separate, coming of his own will, while the third, the Holy Spirit, is abundantly sent forth. In the fire, there reigns a quality whereby each element is neither commanded nor gives a command, for they are all entirely in accord, acting in a unison of love. A unison of love. That's what God is. It was love who was speaking to the disciples at the Last Supper and speaks to us today. It was love who hung on the cross and accomplished the salvation of the world. It was love who rose from the dead on Easter morning. Love's redeeming work is done, fought the fight, the battle won. Lo, our Son's eclipse is o'er, lo, he sets in blood no more. It is love who becomes present in the offering and thanksgiving we will shortly proclaim over the gifts of bread and wine. It is love who will be present as we eat and drink. It is love who will be present spiritually to those of you watching and unable to receive the holy gifts of the Eucharist physically, but who do not desire to unite yourselves with us in prayer to him. As we sing on Holy Thursday, Congregavit nos in unum Christi amor. By the love of Christ have we been brought together. Unworthy though we are, he still gathers us and invites us and remains with us. Love bade me welcome, yet my soul drew back, guilty of dust and sin. But quick-eyed love, observing me grow slack from my first entrance in, drew nearer to me, sweetly questioning if I lacked anything. A guest I answered, worthy to be here. Love said, you shall be he. I, the unkind, ungrateful, ah, my dear, I cannot look on thee. Love took my hand, and smiling did reply, who made the eyes but I? Truth, Lord, but I have marred them. Let my shame go where it doth deserve. And know you not, says love, who bore the blame? My dear, then I will serve. You must sit down, says love, and taste my meat. So I did sit and eat. How blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Let us pray to the Lord in hope and reverence.
Let us pray for those who proclaim the message of Christ, that the Holy Spirit may accompany their words with signs of healing and new life. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for those in civil authority, that they may work with justice and integrity for the people whom they serve. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for those who are sick, that the Lord may heal them in mind and body. We remember all those suffering in the current pandemic, and pray also for Barry Deering, who is to have surgery tomorrow. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Let us pray for those whose generosity has supported the life and work of Glenstall Abbey, that they in turn may receive abundant blessing. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Let us pray for those who have died, John Welsh, who died this week, and Billy Connors, whose 10th anniversary it is, that they may be raised to everlasting life in Christ. Lord, hear us.
Father, Lord of heaven and earth, whose love never ceases to surround your people, hear our prayers and renew our hearts with the Spirit of truth, through Christ our Lord. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that, purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Benedict and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Kieran, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and
the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.